بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلى الله تعالى على سيدنا ومولانا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما نافعا يا كريم. الحمد لله. In our first discussions on the topic of saving our souls, we find that not only do the limbs have obligations and prohibitions by the divinely sanctioned law, but we also see from the Sharia and from the Quran and from the Sunnah that the heart also has obligations and prohibitions. So today we will talk about some of the obligations of the heart, and this is in essence the way of purification of the soul, of reviving the soul, because just like the body needs nourishment in order for the limbs to do its job, just so the heart needs, the soul needs its nourishment in order for the limbs to be able to move in the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the most upright of ways and in accordance to the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So This first lesson we will discuss about the obligations of the heart. What are the obligatory acts for the heart to be engaged in our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So the first of them, which is the most important, and this first few all interlace as well, which is the faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to have a proper belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is why the so much importance and so much encouragement is given to the seeking of Islamic knowledge, because these things are so pertinent in order for a person's relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to have a proper foundation in order to raise in the ranks of closeness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that there is no other way except for having a foundational knowledge in the Sharia, in the sacred law, in the teachings of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And amongst those which are the basic Islamic beliefs, where the obligation, where it is obligatory for us to know those qualities which are obligatory for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and those qualities which are merely possible for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to have, and then those qualities which are absurd to ascribe Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by means of, right? This is an absolute necessity in order for one to increase in their yaqeen and to increase in their sincerity and to increase in all of these other beautiful qualities of the heart. The background for these qualities must be correct faith. Right, so faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which also includes, right, faith in the Messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and all that the Messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has brought, I mean, has been sent with. And this is all combined within the kalima, the statement of the testimony of faith, La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. That inside this statement, you have all of the meanings of divine oneness. You have all of the meanings of the messengership and the prophethood of the greatest of the creation, Muhammad bin Abdullah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam. In there you have a belief in all of what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has brought to us of the transmitted beliefs, such as the belief in the grave and death and life after death and in angels and in jinn and in the states of the Day of Judgment, the bridge of Sirat, the scales where the deeds will be weighed, the mahshar, the gathering place, right? The hawd of the Prophet ﷺ, the water basin of the Prophet ﷺ, or the pond, you can say, and all of the descriptions of heaven and hell. All of that is what the Prophet ﷺ brought, as along with prophetic guidance and along with prophetic instruction. Right, so all of that encompasses faith, and all of that is encompassed in La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. and one of the great earlier scholars, one of the students of Imam Abdullah bin Alawi al-Haddad, he mentions, his name is Abdurrahman bin Abdullah bal-Faqih, he mentions that La ilaha illallah is the focal point of the entire religion, and that everything else that comes in the religion, whatever it may be, is just a commentary on what on La ilaha illallah, on the deep meanings of La ilaha illallah, such as the Qur'an. The Qur'an is a commentary of La ilaha illallah. And within the Qur'an are sub-commentaries, like Ayat al-Kursi and Surah al-Fatiha. That these themselves carry so much meaning, but in essence they all go back to the statement La ilaha illallah. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said that أَفْضَلُ مَا جِدْتُ بِهِ أَنَا وَالنَّبِيُّونَ مِنْ قَبْلِي La ilaha illallah. That the greatest thing that I have come with, as well as those prophets before me, is La ilaha illallah. That there is nothing greater under the sun than this statement, if it's truly upheld and truly believed and truly discovered, that its true realities are discovered. Right? So that is, in essence, the job of the heart, that this is the responsibility of the heart, the trust of the heart, that it embraces these meanings, and these meanings are connected to the fitrah, to the natural state of the human, because prior to our bodies being created, Allah tells us in the Quran that our souls were gathered, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He gathered all of the souls of everyone to be born who from Adam alayhi salam all the way to the last person, and he asked, he said, Alastu bi rabbikum, am I not your Lord? And all of us, whether we remember or not, we said, Bala shahidina, of course, on the contrary, you are our Lord, and we bear witness to that. And so no matter what our minds or our bodies may perceive in this world, our souls still remember that address on that day, and are naturally inclining toward those realities and naturally yearning for those meanings again. And that's why that this kalima la ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah, and the belief in Allah and the belief in the Messenger of Allah and the belief of all of what Allah has brought to us, has sent us, right, that it is something that it would be difficult for one to deny. There would have to be some sort of obstacle in the heart, some sort of damaging factor in the heart, which we'll talk about, like arrogance or pride, or right, for one to be able to deny these realities, because it's a denial of that which one's true essence is yearning for anyway. So the next he says, sincere affirmation. So sincere affirmation in essence is true faith, right? Because just knowing the points of faith is not merely faith itself, right? Knowing that Allah is one and known, right? But one has to agree with that in their heart, right? One has to affirm that in their heart, right? And that affirmation can be there even if a person does not actually say the testimony of faith, right? That if a person believes in their heart that there is only one God, right, and that one God is perfect, and they believe in their heart that Allah, that God sent prophets and messengers, and that the final prophet and messenger is Muhammad bin Abdullah, right, that is faith, right? But it is a condition in order for the body of Muslims to treat that person as a Muslim, right, that we actually hear the testimony of faith, or they claim, or they declare themselves to be Muslim, right? So the affirmation of the tongue, right, is a condition for us to, for the rulings of Islam to apply to that person. For instance, burying a person in a Muslim cemetery, doing the janazah prayer upon them if they pass away, right? And them being a permissible avenue to give zakat to, right, and so forth, that if they didn't actually say the shahada, right, maybe they were born in a place where they didn't know about Islam, right, they didn't find any Muslims present in their area, they researched online, they read about Islam, they saw it's beautiful, but they never read anywhere that you're supposed to say la ilaha illallah, but they believed 100% in it, they are Muslim, right? And they are Muslim, but if they were to have passed away, right, and no one knew that they were Muslim, then obviously, right, the religious rulings of Islam may not be applied on that person. Okay, right. Next he talks about a step up from sincerity, a sincere affirmation, which is conviction. Right. And conviction in Arabic is yaqeen. Right. Yaqeen is absolute certainty. As Imam Abdullah bin Ali al-Haddad, he mentions in the Book of Assistance, and I would advise everyone to read the chapter of yaqeen and certainty in the Book of Assistance. And he says that true conviction is the highest level of faith. And it is حتى يصير الإيمان كجبل راسخ. It is when one's faith becomes so strong that it's like a firm mountain. لا يزلزله الشكوك ولا يمكنه أن يزلزلها. That no doubts could ever shake that mountain, right, or that faith. And nor would it even be conceivable that doubts could ever have an effect on that faith, right? And that is, in essence, true faith. That is absolute faith, right? Even though lower levels of faith are considered faith, these people are believers for sure, right? But the highest level of conviction, right, is, as the Prophet ﷺ said in the hadith where Jibril alayhi salam comes to him and asks him three questions. He asks, what is Islam? What is Iman? And then he asks, what is Ihsan? Right? Ihsan, you could translate it as spiritual excellence or excellence in the religion. He says to worship Allah as if you see him. Right? To worship Allah as if you see him, meaning that your conviction is so strong that you know that Allah is watching you at all times. That you know that Allah is aware of your heart at every moment, that you are aware that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is witnessing every single action, every thought, every word, every intention that comes forth from your heart. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَقَدَ نَعْلَمُ مَا تُوَسْوِسُ بِهِ نَفْسُهُ, right, that we have created the human beings and we know what their hearts whisper to them. Right, that a person knows that for certain. So imagine this, right? Put yourself in this position, that was your reality, that you knew for a fact that every moment, there was never a moment where you were heedless of the fact that Allah is completely watching you, right? And that death is a reality, and that the Day of Judgment is a reality, and that hellfire is real, and that Jannah, paradise, is real, and that the Prophet ﷺ is real, that with absolute certainty, right, how would your prayer be? What would be the difference in your prayer? What would be the difference in your fasting? What would be the difference when you sit to read the Qur'an? What would be the difference when you sit to remember Allah? What would be the difference when you have the choice to react to an ignorant person with ignorance, or to act in a prophetic manner? What would be the difference? So the Prophet ﷺ said, "Al-yaqinu al-imanu kulluhu," that certainty is faith in its entirety. Right? And in the Book of Assistance, we won't go into it here, he talks about three ways to fortify one's certainty. Right? All right, next is sincerity. Right, and some of these overlap, right? That sincerity, right? There's two words in Arabic for sincerity. One is ikhlas, and one is siddiq. That ikhlas, right, is that one's faith is purely for Allah, that one's actions are purely for Allah, that they're not adulterated by any secondary motives, right? But siddiq, right? Siddiq is to be true, to be real with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is, in essence, right, the state of the person with yaqeen, that they are true to Allah, that when they in, that they are true in their speech, they are true in their actions, and they are true in their faith and their states of being, that when they that they act 100% accordingly to what they truly believe. Because one of the great early Muslims, Hassan al-Basri, he saw a group of people and they asked him a question, and amongst his answer, he says that you believe in death, and you believe in a life after death, but you don't prepare for it, right? You believe that the Quran is from Allah, but you don't read it, and you don't act upon it, right? And so on and so forth, right? So those are deficiencies in truthfulness, right? That if one is absolutely truthful, right, that they will interact and they will embrace the injunctions of their deen, right, as if they have full yaqeen in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that these are realities to them, and so that their actions are in 100% accordance to what their faith dictates or entails. Right. Next is remorse for disobedience, right? And this is really important, right? Remorse for disobedience, right? Many people become very despondent, right? And they give up thinking that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created them to become perfect, right? To be perfect, right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has never created us to be perfect, never. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, "Kullu bani Adam khata'un." All of the children of Adam are make mistakes. وَخَيْرُ خَطَّائِينَ التَّوَّابُونَ. Right, and the best of those who make mistakes are those who make tawbah, those who repent and turn back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it is not so much that we are meant to be perfect. We're not meant to be angels. Rather, it is sought from us to know for a fact that we are not perfect, and to be fully aware that only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is perfect, and that not if, but when we slip up and when we err, that we turn back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in repentance. And the first and most important condition for repentance to be valid and sincere is remorse for sins, right? To feel bad about the sins, right? And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, إِذَا سَرَّتْكَ حَسَنَتُكَ وَسَاءَتْكَ سَيِّئَتُكَ فَأَنْتَ مُؤْمِن. If your good deeds make you feel good and your bad deeds make you feel bad, then you are a true believer, right? Notice he didn't say that a true believer is the one who doesn't do good bad deeds, right? But a true believer would never want to do that which is displeasing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala intentionally, right? It is only by means of, right, a state of heedlessness, a bad decision, or an overpowering of the nafs, of the ego and the desires, and reacting to some situation, then they slip and they do something wrong. But they would never have wanted to do that, right? And they're not happy that they did that, and it makes them feel bad. As the Prophet ﷺ said in another hadith, Al-ithmu ma haka fi sadrik, that sin is that which bothers your heart. وَكَرِهَتَ أَيَّطَّدِعَ عَلِهِ النَّاسِ, and you would dislike that the people become aware of it, right? That is sin. Right, so the sensitivity to sins is a very good state. It is a good state of the heart. The problem is that when a person becomes persistent on certain sins, that and the sin itself, as bad as it may be, is not as worse as the tolerance level of the heart increasing for sins. That now, if they were to do a sin, it doesn't really bother them. Like, that is more of a punishment, and that is more of a consequence of a severe consequence of sins than the actual sin itself, right? So, so this remorse for the sin is true slavehood to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So by means of this, we can understand how egregious it is for one to flaunt their sins and to brag about their sins and to expose their sins after Allah has already veiled them from the creation. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive us our sins and to make us of the penitent people and to turn us back to Him in at all times and all moments, that in a complete admission of our deficiencies to Him subhanahu wa ta'ala, that He may rectify our states and accept us and draw us near to Him. وصلى الله تعالى على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم والحمد لله رب العالمين.